Diamo il benvenuto cordiale a tutti, tutte le persone di Loppiano, dell'intorno, di Sofia. Un benvenuto speciale a Jule Spears Brooker, nostro ospite. Allora, io comincio con due frasi in italiano per farvi sentire a casa. Dopo parlerò in inglese per fare sentire a casa Jewel. Però avete anche la traduzione, no? Funzionano tutte le traduzioni? Sì. Allora, ho già detto a lei quello che dirò. Potrebbe sembrare un po' strano a qualcuno che una illustra professoressa di letteratura viene presentato da una matematica. Che collegamento ci può essere? Ma voi sapete che Sofia è l'università dell'interdisciplinarità. E una cosa molto interessante mi ha detto Jule, il primo giorno quando siamo incontrate, che lei ha cominciato studiando, diciamo, ragioneria, i numeri. E perché ha studiato i numeri? Perché il professore aveva fatto un collegamento fra la sapienza e i numeri. Lei era attirato dalla sapienza. Poi questa sete per la sapienza li ha portato a studiare la letteratura e sentiremo oggi anche la profondità. Giusto così per cominciare. Now I will continue in English. So, to the rostrum of illustrious personalities who've held the Sofia Lecture at our University Institute in these 8 years of its existence, and among whom we can mention Italian professors like Zamani, Zervoli, Ugualdi, Severino, Enzo Bianchi, the Abbot of Bose, John Pillet, the rector of Liverpool Hope University, Cardinal Ouellet, the American philosopher Martha Nussbaum. Today we have the joy and honor to add to this list the name of Jule S. Brooker, whom Professor Rosé will soon present to us. Jule is one of the most eminent scholars of Thomas Stearns Eliot, T.S. Eliot. Before giving the floor to Professor Rosé to present Miss Brooker, let me say just a few words regarding the poet whom she will speak about. T.S. Eliot is a poet, essayist, playwright, U.S.-born, naturalized British citizen, winner of the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1948. And I think most of you have heard this name, but not everyone knows the depth of meaning in this man. Eliot's poetry is often critical of the frivolity and emptiness of Western society. Etched in my mind are some lines that many years ago, as a high school student, I had to learn by heart. We are the hollow men, we are the stuffed men, headpiece filled with straw. Or another, this is the way the world ends, this is the way the world ends, this is the way the world ends, not with a bang, but a whimper. Although I was only 15 years old at the time, in memorizing those verses, I clearly sensed something of the depth of thought that Eliot was trying to convey, a depth that through and beyond the words of the artist, the poet, led to the transcendent. In the words of Eliot, and I quote, "Poetry may make us from time to time a little more aware of the deeper unnamed feelings which form the substratum of our being. to which we rarely penetrate, for our lives are mostly a constant evasion of ourselves. Today, Jewel, with her talk entitled Poetry and Transcendence, The Word in the Desert, will help us to penetrate and taste the gift that T.S. Eliot has to offer, introducing us to its multiple implications. It is a particular tribute to the interdisciplinary and transdisciplinary nature of our institute that today, after other Sophia lectures on economy, philosophy, nuclear physics, you are here today, Jewel, to immerse us in English literature, especially in its implications in our thirst for wisdom. Thank you, Jewel, for coming. Thank you for being our guide to discover the word in the desert. And I now pass the microphone to Professor Rosé, who will present Jewel.
Ecco, io faccio una breve presentazione di Jewel. Il mio inglese è un po' approssimativo, mi scusate. Quindi io ho avuto la gioia di incontrare la dottoressa nel 2002 in occasione del congresso di René Girard, no? Alla Purdue University negli Stati Uniti, è abbastanza vicino a Chicago. Ecco. E da quel momento siamo sempre rimasti in contatto epistolare, diciamo per posta elettronica si intende, ed è nata una bellissima amicizia. Ecco. Ho ancora avuto la possibilità di rivedere Jewel a Londra qualche anno più tardi, dove ha tenuto una conferenza su Eliot, e lei stessa è già venuta due volte a Lupiano e l'ultima volta a Sofia, dove ha potuto incontrare e conoscere il nostro preside Piero Coda e altri naturalmente. La nostra amicizia dura quindi già da parecchi anni e è piuttosto originale, poiché lei non capisce l'italiano e io altrettanto dell'inglese. Comunque Jewel è un po' sa leggere il francese e io un po' l'inglese come lettura, no? E quindi lei mi scrive in inglese, io in francese, e arriviamo a intenderci. Ho preso coscienza poco a poco che mi trovavo dinanzi forse alla più grande studiosa a livello mondiale dello scrittore e poeta moderno Eliot, del quale è coeditrice della prima edizione dell'opera completa in prosa, opera che l'anno scorso ha raggiunto l'ottavo volume, forse già il 9 adesso. Non oso chiedere a Jewel quando è nata, ma comunque potete vedere che è una signora molto giovanile e elegante, no? Ha fatto i suoi studi in Florida, negli Stati Uniti, specializzandosi in letteratura e particolarmente in letteratura religiosa. Oggi lei è professoressa emerita, appunto, di letteratura alle Eckhart College nella città di St. Petersburg in Florida. Ma nella sua esistenza professionale è stata chiamata a insegnare e a tenere conferenze in quasi tutti i continenti. Mi sembra che manca l'Australia, se non mi sbaglio. In Giappone, così come in Africa del Sud, in particolare come professoressa invitata all'Università Ebraica di Gerusalemme e nelle più prestigiose università degli Stati Uniti come la Harvard, la Yale e Columbia University e in Europa a Oxford e Cambridge. Ed è venuta a parlare perfino a Firenze. Non posso enumerare tutti i suoi impegni in congressi, associazioni, né le onorificenze ricevute, né tutte le sue pubblicazioni. Soltanto l'elenco dei suoi vari articoli che ho avuto sotto gli occhi costituiscono quasi un volume a se stessa, sono non so quante pagine. Non posso che ringraziare la professoressa Jouen per il grande onore che fa al nostro piccolo istituto universitario, per aver accettato di venire specialmente dagli Stati Uniti e passare qualche giorno a Sofia e svolgere la cattedra di quest'anno. E quindi invita Joël a colmarci della sua scienza e della sua sapienza. Grazie.
Grazie, Professor Rose and Professor Povilas. Thank you for your generous introduction and your warm welcome. I was telling someone else that in Lopiano, I feel embraced. Even though you don't know me, I feel beloved by you, and that's a wonderful feeling. I'm also grateful to President Pierre Coda, Julie Tremblay, and Hong, a friend of several years. To Jonathan Michelino, who kindly translated these remarks, we must all say grazie, grazie, mille grazie. It is an honor and a blessing to be with you in this beautiful place. And now to my lecture. My epigraph is from T.S. Eliot. If only a part of the meaning can be conveyed by paraphrase, that is because the poet is occupied with frontiers of consciousness beyond which words fail, though meanings still exist. A little more than 700 years ago, Dante Alighieri was exiled from his native Florence. He spent the rest of his life wandering in these Italian hills, dependent for bread and bed on the kindness of strangers. In these circumstances, he composed one of the greatest poems in European literature, the Commedia, the tripartite epic of the Christian afterlife. Who doesn't recognize the opening lines? Midway in the journey of our life, I woke to find myself in a dark wood, for I had wandered away from the straight path. This launches Dante's memory of a dreamlike journey through hell, purgatory, and paradise. Allegorically, through the recognition of evil, the purging of its roots, and the achievement of blessedness. To assist him along the way, Dante has three guides. The first is Virgil, author of the Aeneid, a poem he knew by heart. The second is Beatrice, the Florentine woman he had loved since childhood, whose love inaugurated and sustained his movement towards God. And the third is Saint Bernard, theologian and founder of the Abbey at Clairvaux. Virgil, who epitomizes human reason, is his guide as he descends into the pit and then climbs the penitential mountain. At the top of the mountain, Beatrice, who represents both herself and divine revelation, replaces Virgil and guides Dante into paradise. Saint Bernard, who represents contemplation, appears at the end and enables him to secure the mystical experience that concludes this great poem. One of the most powerful symbols in the entire Commedia occurs as Dante, led by his beloved Beatrice, approaches the divine union in paradise. When he first meets her at the top of Mount Purgatory, she is concealed behind a white veil. As they ascend, he is allowed to see first her eyes and later her mouth. Moreover, he is permitted a fleeting glimpse of Christ in glory. at the climax of these ineffable experiences, Beatrice says to Dante the pilgrim, "Open your eyes, look straight into my face. You have been witness to such things that now you have the power to endure my smile." Dante, the poet, who is attempting to remember this smile, interrupts his story and apologizes for his inability to describe it or convey its significance. He is working at what Eliot calls the frontiers of consciousness, the sites at which words are overwhelmed by transcendent reality. As Dante says of the moment in which Beatrice smiled, "If at this moment all the tongues of verse which Polyhymnia and her sisters nourished with their sweet milk sang to assist my art, their singing would not come to 1,000th part of the truth about her sacred smile, nor see how it set her holy face aglow." The significance of this smile beggars all description. The greatest poets, including Dante himself, are rendered speechless. Choirs of angels are unable to convey more than a fraction of its meaning. At this point, Dante instructs the reader to make a leap, to jump across the reality signified by such a smile and move on. With the symbolism of this smile as backdrop, I now leap over 7 centuries to consider 2 20th century thinkers, the poet T.S. Eliot and the philosopher Eric Voegelin. Both were admirers of Dante, and both were interested in the issue suggested by Beatrice's smile, namely, how a symbol can bridge the temporal and the transcendent realms. Both were exiles, though unlike Dante, each found a home in a new country. Eliot was born in 1888 in St. Louis beside the Mississippi River. Finding himself trapped in England during the First World War, he remained, and in 1927 he became a British citizen and a member of the Church of England. Voegelin was born in Cologne in 1901, and in the late 1930s he fled from the Nazis and settled in the United States, where he had a successful career as a philosopher and as a university professor. Eliot's work was published before and during the First World War, the Second World War. Voegelin's was published between the 1950s and the 1980s. Partially as a result of reading Eliot's poetry, especially 4 quartets, Voegelin came to understand the importance of symbols in conveying truth. Voegelin is one of several modern philosophers who discussed the attenuation of transcendent experience in 20th century life. He approaches the problem by analyzing religious symbols, by which he means the words, concepts, pictures we use in religious discourse. A symbol, as he defines it, is something that emerges from experience. And to be meaningful, it needs to have a relation to the experience of the person who uses it. The unfathomable magic of Beatrice's smile, for example, is anchored in Dante's experience of human and divine love. Voegelin points out that religious symbols, including words, are especially susceptible to decay because they do not refer to objects, but to experiences that by definition are intangible and non-transferable. Faith, for example, is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. As time passes, it is inevitable for a gap to develop between the primary experience and its symbolization, reducing the symbol to a hollow shell. In St. Paul's image, a sounding gong or a clanging cymbal. Here is Voigtland's succinct summary of this concept. When the experience engendering the symbol ceases to be a presence located in the man who uses the symbol, the reality from which the symbol derives its meaning has disappeared. The symbols, in the sense of words, are left as traces, but their meaning can be understood only if they evoke and through evocation reconstitute the engendering reality in the listener or reader. Voigtland makes two points here that I would like to examine separately. First, the loss of substance in religious symbols. And second, the possible recovery of meaning. Both are represented in Eliot's poetry, which simultaneously depicts the spiritual desert identified by Voigtland and points beyond it to the radiance that can emerge from a reconnection of the idea with the spiritual experience. The philosopher describes the situation, but paradoxically, insofar as he is working almost entirely with intellectual constructs, he also reveals the problem. The poet, in contrast, is dealing with a complex of intelligence and emotion. With the smile of Beatrice, Dante puts flesh on the skeleton and thus confirms what the great English poet William Wordsworth refers to as intimations of immortality. The loss of meaning in religious symbols, according to Voigtland, occurs in stages. The authentic symbol originates as a word or concept or picture, undergirded by an experience. As the substratum of experience weakens and disappears, the symbol assumes the form of doctrine, an abstract concept that takes on a life of its own. In the next phase, the doctrine becomes part of theory and is used in theological and philosophical disputations, ranging from relativism to agnosticism to how do you know? And finally, the symbol is recognized as jargon by the common person and tossed into the dustbin of religious history. One of Eliot's early poems, Mr. Eliot's Sunday Morning Service, reveals the stages by which a rich religious concept crumbles into mumbo jumbo. It also suggests that art has special advantages in the preservation and transmission of truth. The title is ironic, for it promises a weekly religious service, presumably Christian. At the same time, it associates that service with a poet known at this point in his life as a skeptic or an agnostic. The title thus generates the image of a modern intellectual whose Sunday morning ritual is writing poetry. The opening lines suggest that the poem is to be a highbrow satire on institutional religion. The tone is formal, even stately. The diction, which is Latinate and Greek, resembles that of a theological treatise. Mr. Eliot's Sunday Morning Service. Polyphiloprogenitive, the sapient sutlers of the Lord drift across the window panes. In the beginning was the Word. In the beginning was the Word, superfetation of Tohen, and at the mensual turn of time produced innervate origin. The central symbol is one of the richest in philosophical and religious history. The Word, capital W, that is the Greek and Christian logos. The text for this service, quoted twice, comes from the opening of John's Gospel. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, was with God, and the Word was God. But despite the seriousness of the concept, it is embedded in a ceremony that undercuts it. The figures moving up the aisle, presumably the clergy, are seen as sapient sutlers. A sutler is a merchant who follows an army in order to sell things to the soldiers and make money. A sapient sutler, ironically, would be one who maximizes his profits. The first line, which consists of a single word, is an eight-syllable blockbuster with Greek and Latin roots. In the 19th century, philoprogenitive, which literally means love of begetting, love of producing offspring, referred in theological treatises to the all-begetting divine, and in vulgar parlance, to sexual promiscuity. Lots of jokes about this, of course. Eliot adds the intensifying prefix poly and applies the word to the merchandisers of religion who have generated millions of words from the one word, from the logos. The image of unchecked fertilization of the word continues in the second stanza with another $100 line, superfetation of tohen. Superfetation refers to the formation of secondary fetuses in a woman who is already pregnant, and tohen is Greek for the incomprehensible philoprogenitive one, the logos. The command to be fruitful and multiply here is applied to the logos, calling attention to the tradition of biblical interpretation and preparing the way for the appearance of origin. One of the most prolific of the early church fathers, he was known for lengthy disquisitions on the logos, and in fact wrote entire books on the first chapter of John's gospel. But as Eliot's line reminds us, Origen was enervate, a reference to the fact that he castrated himself to eliminate the distractions of the flesh and concentrate on the fruit of the intellect, words about words, commentaries about commentaries. Part of Eliot's irony comes from the jarring incongruity between Origen's attitude toward the flesh and that of St. John, who associated the logos with incarnation. And the word was made flesh and dwelt among us. What has happened to the logos? Voegelin would say that with the passage of the two centuries between John and Origen, the experience that grounded the concept in the first place has been overlaid by volumes of arcane commentary. This overlaying of the concept, in fact, is a decarnation of the logos. Origen's self-castration becomes a symbol of the castration of the logos itself. It survives as a word in the gospel, as a doctrine in theological disputes, as a fancy word for intellectual poets like T.S. Eliot, but not as a truth grounded in the incarnation. As the poem unfolds, it becomes clear that it is not only a satire of institutional religion, but of highbrow poetry. The use of words such as polyphiloprogenitive not only mocks Origen, but the poet who spends his Sundays coming up with such outlandish words. Instead of pointing beyond themselves to substance, such verbal concoctions call attention to themselves as empty shells. The poem concludes by displaying a third Sunday morning service, that of a non-intellectual who works during the week and on Sundays relaxes in his bathtub. Sweeney shifts from ham to ham, stirring the waters in his bath. The masters of the subtle schools are controversial polymath. In this parody of baptism, the Irishman dismisses both theologians and poets as masters of gibberish. In moving from Origen to Sweeney, we have gone from a disembodied mind in a library to a mindless body in a hot tub. Sweeney represents the final stage in Vogelin's theory of the evacuation of meaning from symbols. But this degeneration of meaning is not the whole story. In the center of this poem, the poet points to a work of ecclesiastical art. A painter of the Umbrian school designed upon a gesso ground the nimbus of the baptized god. The wilderness is cracked and browned. But through the water, pale and thin, still shine the unoffending feet. And there above, the painter set the father and the paraclete. Eliot does not name the painter of the Umbrian school, but it is assumed to be Piero della Francesca, the Tuscan artist whose baptism of Christ was painted in the 1450s for a nearby chapel dedicated to John the Baptist. Eliot saw the painting in the National Gallery in London and marked it in his Baedeker. The juxtapositions of the two symbols, the logos and the painting, is a vivid reminder that philosophical concepts are more vulnerable to dilution than truth embodied in art. Even though more than five centuries have passed, the feet of Jesus are still shining and still unoffending. Thus, this painting preserves not only the image of the master's feet, but the truth embodied in the image. The divinity that makes the feet luminous and the human perfection that makes them innocent. These truths are still perceivable because great art objectifies abstractions such as luminosity and innocence, transforming them into objects that can be transmitted to other times and places. Note too that with the line, "The wilderness is cracked and brown," Eliot telescopes the baptism and the temptation of Christ. Thus, in the center of this poem about the desert of modernity, we find an image of the word in the desert. To return to Vogelin's discussion of religious symbols, he not only describes the loss of meaning, but also its potential recovery. In his analysis, recovery is dependent upon two factors. The first is an understanding of time that includes both the temporal and the timeless. The second is sensitivity to the traces of transcendence in nature and personal experience. Adapting a term from Plato, he asserts that we live in a metaxy, which a priestess in the Symposium defines as an in-between or middle ground. The reconstitution of religious experience presupposes an awareness of our middle state, experienced as tension between the finite and the infinite, time and eternity, immanence and transcendence. Vogelin associates this metaxy or middle ground with becoming, with moving forward towards the spiritual realm. He attributes the malaise in contemporary consciousness to a triumph of secularism and the consequent attenuation of our collective awareness of this in-between. This is because modern thinkers have collapsed the timeless into the temporal, a move that greatly reduces the possibility of perceiving transcendent meaning. Voigtlin's second factor, sensitivity to the presence of God in history and in personal experience, is mentioned in the brief paragraph quoted earlier. He points out that the loss of meaning is not absolute and need not be final. This is a repetition from the earlier quote. The symbols in the sense of words are left as traces, but their meaning can be understood only if they evoke and through evocation reconstitute the engendering reality in the listener or reader. If a person is sensitive to the traces of transcendent reality that remain in words and in everyday life, he can claim those traces as a portal for accessing his first world or her first world. Central to my argument is the claim that poetry is a major instrument for evoking the substratum of experience that sustains and restores religious meaning. The greatest poets in every period are among those most conscious of the metaxy. By the nature of their work with language, they dwell between immanence and transcendence, between the effable and the ineffable. Dante's Commedia is a monument to this awareness of transcendence. The main image of the poem is the landscape of the soul, the territory between this world and the beyond, between the finite and the infinite. The smile of Beatrice is equally a memory of a beautiful smile on earth, and an evocation of a beatific smile in the presence of God. In substantiation of this argument, I now turn to Eliot's late masterpiece, Four Quartets. These philosophical poems were written several years after his 1927 conversion. The conversion brought not only a change of heart, but a change of style, moving from satire to meditation, and from opacity to transparency. The new style was influenced by his appreciation of classical music. In 1931, he told Stephen Spencer that Beethoven's late quartets, which he kept on his gramophone, seemed to be, quote, the fruit of relief after immense suffering. Reflecting on his own art, Eliot said, "I should like to get something of that into verse before I die, at least once." In a lecture at Yale in 1933, he said, "I have long aimed to write poetry with nothing poetic about it, poetry so transparent that we see not the poetry, but that which we are meant to see through the poetry, poetry so transparent that in reading it, we are intent on what the poem points at and not the poetry, to get beyond poetry as Beethoven in his late quartets strove to get beyond music." Beethoven's music, like Beatrice's smile, is inexhaustible. It reaches beyond itself into the silence, and henceforth that is Eliot's ambition: to write poetry that reaches into silence, that points across Jordan into timelessness. Eliot's ambition was realized in Four Quartets. The poem consists of four parallel meditations, structurally connected by analogies with music, with the four seasons and the four elements, and thematically connected by variations on the meaning of keeping time in time. This eloquent sequence presents a striking contrast to poems such as Mr. Eliot's Sunday Morning Service. At the same time, it extends the poet's early preoccupation with the limitations of language and the meaning of the logos. In the early poem, he mocks the theologian's over-fertilization of the logos and the poet's verbal anemia. In the quartets, by contrast, he approaches these matters with gravity. "Words strain, crack, and sometimes break. Under the burden, under the tension, slip, slide, perish, will not stay in place, decay with imprecision, will not stay still. Shrieking voices, scolding, mocking, or merely chattering always assail them. The word in the desert is most attacked by voices of temptation, the crying shadow in the funeral dance, the loud lament of the disconsolate Chimera. The passage contrasts the impediments faced by the poet with the temptations faced by Christ in the wilderness. For the poet, the struggle involves the desire to make poetry do more than language can do, and the necessity of purifying language debased by the rhetoric of politicians and the chit-chat of socialites and scoundrels alike. For the word in the desert, the temptations, being demonic, are far greater. In his meditation on the paradoxical nature of human existence, Eliot assumes, as does Voigtlin, that humans live in and in between. The temporal is associated with the material world and with movement, the timeless with the spiritual world and with stillness. From a God's eye view, these intersecting, interpenetrating realities are not two, but one. At the still point of the turning world, neither flesh nor fleshless, neither from nor towards, at the still point, there the dance is, but neither arrest nor movement, and do not call it fixity, where past and future are gathered, neither movement nor from nor towards, neither ascent nor decline. Except for the point, the still point, there would be no dance, and there is only the dance. I can only say there we have been, but I cannot say where, and I cannot say how long, for that would be to place it in time. The evocation of foundational experience is dependent on this concept of time. If history is understood merely as chronos, then it is meaningless to speak of kairos. The first has to do with sequence, the second with a fixed point, a moment of intersection and clarification that splits chronos into a before and an after. On the other hand, if time and the timeless are interpenetrating parts of a greater whole, then it becomes possible to imagine redeeming the time. Eliot uses various images to show the interdependence of movement and stillness. As a wheel cannot turn without a fixed axle, the world cannot turn without a still point. The river cannot flow without the sea. The ballerina cannot pirouette without the dance. Eliot parallels his emphasis on time and timelessness with an emphasis on place and placelessness. The title of each quartet refers to a specific place. One, The Dry Salvages, refers to North America. The other three to England. Burnt Norton to the rose garden of an old manor house. East Coker to the grounds of St. Michael's Church, and Little Gidding to a family sanctuary and chapel. Dry Salvages in the North Atlantic, Little Gidding just north of Cambridge. These are abandoned, empty, time-ridden places, but they contain whispers and echoes, traces of transcendence. As time and space-bound creatures, we can only experience the divine in a specific place at a specific time. The crucial place, however, is neither history nor heaven, but in ourselves, where history and heaven meet. At the still point, there the dance is. The antecedent of there is the frontier of consciousness, a liminal space in which the traces of transcendence reveal themselves to the mind through the senses. Here, the intersection of the timeless moment is England and nowhere, never and always. Notice that nowhere is also now here, contains the paradox. Eliot reveals two main routes to the frontier of consciousness. The first is memory. The second is art. Memory recollects moments of heightened consciousness moments of inattention to the map and the clock. To be conscious is not to be in time, but only in time can the moment in the rose garden, the moment in the arbor where the rain beat, the moment in the drafty church at Smokefall be remembered. Involved with past and future, only through time, time is conquered. Memory is selective, and to redeem the time, it garners remembrances of luminescence, epiphonic moments that disclose traces of presence. Whisper of running streams and winter lightning, the wild thyme unseen and the wild strawberry, the laughter in the garden, echoed ecstasy. Eliot emphasizes the revelatory nature of these moments. Whispers, echoes, the pungent aroma of the wild thyme, the laughter of hidden children. These images recur as a leitmotif running through all four quartets. For most of us, there is only the unattended moment, the moment in and out of time, the wild thyme unseen, or the winter lightning, or the waterfall, or music heard so deeply that it is not heard at all. But you are the music while the music lasts. These memories culminate in the final section of Little Gidding, the last of the quartets. At the source of the longest river, the voice of the hidden waterfall, and the children in the apple tree, not known because not looked for, but heard, half heard, in the stillness between two waves of the sea. The intersections substantiated by memory provide a paradigm for thinking about a much greater interpenetration of mind and matter, spirit and flesh. These are only hints and guesses, hints followed by guesses, the hint half guessed, the gift half understood is incarnation. This chimes with Vogelin's argument that the grounding experience of symbols can be reclaimed. Traces remain, and sensitivity to those traces can evoke and through evocation reconstitute the engendering reality for the listener or the reader. For most of us, incarnation is an empty word, an empty shell. But to the readers of four quartets, as indicated by the capital letter, incarnation, as indicated by the capital letter, it is a reality, a gift half understood. Poetry, and indeed all great art, provides another path to the frontier of consciousness. Words move, music moves only in time, but that which is only living can only die. Words, after speech, reach into the silence. Only by the form, the pattern, can words or music reach the stillness, as a Chinese jar still moves perpetually in its stillness. Not the stillness of the violin while the note lasts, not that only, but the coexistence, or say that the end precedes the beginning, and the end and the beginning were always there, before the beginning and after the end, and all is always now. In four quartets, Eliot extends the incarnational principle of remembered moments to poetry, which, after all, is an incarnation, isn't it, of mind. And as such, poetry reconnects movement and stillness, or to use Voegelin's terminology, experience and symbols. This interpenetration of movement and stillness can be understood as a union of content and form. Content in art is associated with movement, with memory, with the senses, with the particular, with the dancer. Form, on the other hand, is associated with the dance, with the pattern, with timelessness, with intellect, with the universal. Form is of the essence, for as indicated in Eliot's line, it is only by the form that the still point comes into view. In four quartets, form is evident, beginning with the number four. Four poems, four places, four seasons, four Eliot, four elements. Plato explains what happens when one creates such a series. God made one bed in nature, and one only. Two or more neither have been nor ever will be made by God. Even if he had made two, a third would appear, of which they both possess the form, and that would be the real bed, and not the two others. Analogously, reading four parallel poems generates a pattern, an Eliotian quartet. The use of repetition is much on display in four quartets. One of the clearest examples is the use of meteorological images. You're able to see that. It's a lovely photograph. These meteorological images that suggest the reality of a connection between heaven and earth. Winter lightning, for example, supported by winter sun striking ponds. For those who have collapsed the timeless into the span of their lives, winter lightning may be no more than an electrical discharge from a thundercloud. For those with an analogical imagination, it is far more. This unforeseen, unrepeatable event, characterized by brilliance, beauty, and danger, brings to mind the sudden penetration of movement with stillness, of Chronos with Kairos. Another image, the midwinter sun, is behind a motif that runs throughout Eliot's oeuvre, Tongues of Flame, culminating in his last poem, Little Gidding, where the bright sun flames the ice on the shortest day of the year. It ushers in a moment of spring in winter, a perception that for the poet suggests the tongues of Pentecost. The tongues return as he thinks of the dead and dying in war-torn Europe. The communication of the dead is tongued with fire beyond the language of the living. This, by the way, is on Eliot's memorial in Westminster Abbey. In another variation, he thinks of the Holy Spirit as he watches the fire shooting from the gray dove-shaped bombers circling London. Little Gidding was written during the Blitz, during the bombing of London. The dove descending breaks the air with flame of incandescent terror, of which the tongues declare the one discharge from sin and error. In the final section, in the figure of a rose, the poet collects and unifies previous meanings, including beauty and terror, justice and love. And all shall be well, all manner of things shall be well, when the tongues of flame are enfolded into the crowned knot of fire, and the fire and the rose are one. In this final configuration, the tongues of flame as petals of a rose suggest that the poet is thinking of the interpenetration of good and evil, that he is struggling with theodicy, to which end he quotes the 14th century mystic Julian of Norwich, who insisted during the Black Death that all shall be well. The association of the rose arising from the flames of war with the mystical rose of Dante's Paradiso is a reminder that we have reached the point of silence, the point at which we are stopped, and like the reader of Dante, we must make a leap. We had the experience, but missed the meaning. An approach to the meaning restores the experience in a different form beyond any meaning we can assign to happiness. Thank you. The ghost of Eliot beckons me from the shadows.
Adesso apriamo il dialogo. Sì, sono il traduttore. Anche i vostri commenti, quello che è suscitato.
First of all, I'd like to thank Jewel for a beautiful lecture on transcendence in Eliot. A couple of questions came to mind. You know, Eliot, it was in his own way a complicated individual, and that's not a put-down. I think we're all complicated. And so this element of the metaxy, first, you know, that Vogland takes from Plato, in what sense would you think the metaxy itself expressed the tension in Eliot's own life? And for example, reading up a little bit on him, you see the beauty in this poetry of reaching up to that other world, and yet there's the complications, for example, where, and not because I'm putting him down, but if it's just the reality, you know, it's the last 8 years, your last 8 or 10 years, his wife was put into an asylum, and he never even once went to visit her, you know. So there was tensions there, that would be one. And then in the use of the word, the nowhere and now here, nowhere, you know, England and nowhere. Well, nowhere is actually a literal translation of utopia, And I was wondering, did he have that also in mind when, you know, again, was there this charis moment, a utopic moment?
Well, Eliot did have a complicated life. And his wife was ill, and she was in hospital. But I would say the tension in Eliot, in part, is between the early and the later Eliot, and in Four Quartets. He's dealing with both parts of that tension. In Burnt Norton, there's a lovely lyric: "Garlic and sapphires in the mud, clot the bedded axle tree." Garlic, sapphires, mud, so could you frame your question? Well, he was extremely conscious of this tension of being rooted in the mud, but of always reaching upward, and even in the early Eliot, you have that this religious instinct, always unrealized, always unsatisfied, and. So I think it's actually a perfect image of his own life. But in the quartets, he brings it all together. So, but he was not a perfect person, of course, as none of us are. And he was a wonderful poet. And
as I said, I wasn't trying to put him down. I think in his humanness, you discover more who we are, you know.
Right.
So the beauty of reaching up, you see it there.
Right.
The quest to transcend, self-transcend, and yet being aware of your own weakness.
Well, it's only when you're aware of your own weakness that the reach really makes any sense, isn't it?
I am not knowledgeable enough to ask a question, but I do have to say that you rekindled in me a love for poetry that I had when I was a teenager in school and read Frost and others and also Eliot and memorized the same lines that Judy had to memorize. But as a more recent resident of Tuscany, I have had the opportunity to visit just a few of the wonderful works of art, which are certainly symbols of the religious religiosity and history, but I was trying to take notes, but I was too taken by what you were saying, and I only got, and you were talking about the advantages that art has for symbols, and I just wondered if you could expound a bit on that, because I was following you after that and did not take any more notes. But thank you very much. It was very...
Well, I think the advantages of art are that art embodies or incarnates mind and beauty and all of these things in a form. It objectifies them so that they become transferable, they become tangible. And the logos can lose its meaning, but the painting, you know, retains its shininess, its luminosity. And the poem that you referred to and that Judy quoted, The Hollow Men, this is a poem that is about the betweenness between the idea and the reality falls the shadow. Eliot is the great poet of the in-between, of the metaxy, I think. The shadow, you know, in the hollow men, between the idea and the reality falls the shadow. He tries to pray, Our Father, which art, and then the prayer just crumbles into fragments as he goes along. He can't get out of the shadow. But in Four Quartets, at least as an aspiration, I think he gets out of it. But not entirely, you know. The poem would, in a way, I think if he were totally out of it, it would just be an elegant form of nothingness or atheism, you know. He's the poet to me of the great in between. Yes.
Ciao, sono Charles. Grazie di questo tuffo che tu ci hai fatto fare in Eliot. Io ho conosciuto Eliot forse 10 anni fa e ogni tanto lo visito perché lui ha vissuto dei momenti tremendi dell'umanità tra la Prima Guerra Mondiale e la crisi del 29 e anche la Seconda Guerra Mondiale e è riuscito a trasformare in sostanza poetica la vita sociale e le domande più atroci dell'umanità, diciamo. Però mi colpisce molto questa concezione del tempo che lui ha. E è quello che voglio domandarti sulla concezione del presente, soprattutto in quella poesia che lui parla di questi uomini impagliati che svuota il capitalismo che svuota di significato l'uomo e anche la concezione della vita come dono d'amore. I nostri giorni d'amore sono pochi, facciamo almeno che siano divini. In questi momenti presenti che cogliamo la vita come dono d'amore e la parte che tocca a noi di vivere il presente.
Well, I agree with that. And the present moment, I think, is the still point. And you always have to enter through the present. And the concept of time, Eliot, Oscar Kuhlman, the theologian, has a wonderful book on Christ and time, and Eliot was influenced by this book. But it's actually a concept of time that combines some Buddhist ideas. Eliot studied Buddhism and almost became a Buddhist when he was writing The Wasteland, and with his own experience of time, of living in time, and of redeeming the time and of trying to keep time, both hold on to it, but dance along with it, you know, live with its rhythms, and in time. So, you know, the idea of redeeming the time, I think, is central to Eliot, and he pulls all of these other concepts into the Christian concept of redeeming the time, in time. Only in time can you redeem the time.
Thank you. Well, the four quartets looks like kind of a progression, of consciousness that would overcome suffering, because it has like movements like what we see in music. So Eliot, it is true that in the four quartets he, or we can say that it has a very highly personal implication, but at the same time he conveys a kind of a message, a spiritual message to his time. So what kind of a spiritual message Eliot conveyed to his own time through the four quartets, even though it has a highly personal implication because it's his own experience? What does it imply to live the timelessness in time, to live beyond time in time, to his own society, the context in which he wrote the four quartets?
Mm-hmm. Well, the last three quartets were written during the Second World War. And during the Second World War, Eliot was he was too old to be a soldier, of course, but he was a fire watcher on the rooftops in London. And he writes of this experience in Little Gidding, of walking home at dawn through bombed streets with ashes everywhere, and the ashes include not only buildings but people. But the universal part, I think, is in the form. It's through the form, through the beautiful elegance of the form and the images that you can reach the still point. So the bombing and all of those things, those are part of the movement. The stillness has to do with the form, but the form and the content are one. That's part of the embodying. That's part of the incarnation involved in art. Art is always a mini incarnation. It's an incarnation of experience, of time, of humanity. Incarnation with a small I. But it's because of this incarnation with a small I that we understand the hints and guesses, and we can accept incarnation with a capital I. But I find the four quartets extremely meaningful for my own life. The theologian Reinhold Niebuhr said that he read the quartets over and over again for a period of 40 years, almost as devotional material, because with great poetry and with great paintings too and great music, every time you come to them, they give you more. They give you something else, something beyond. And so this is part of the glory, of course, of art. And this is not true of philosophy. I mean, this is part of Vogelin's point that words and concepts can be emptied out, but art really cannot be emptied out in the same way. And I think that is really true.
Before the next question, let me introduce the questioner also to our audience. You know, you met Professor Don Mitchell yesterday.
Oh, yes.
Maybe not everyone knows. He was also one of our speakers here 2 years ago, I think. And Dan, would you like to stand up? A professor of Buddhism in Purdue University. Okay, Dan, go ahead.
Yes. We had a conversation earlier today where you talked a little bit about his interest in Buddhism and his study prior to his conversion, and I mentioned that one of the rather important Dharma talks by an American Buddhist that was given earlier this year was on the flame and the rose. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't aware of the situation in which he wrote this in. I mean, it was really a terrible, and now you say that his job was to watch this.
You watch the bombers coming in.
Yeah.
So this little Gideon is a real theodicy.
Yeah. Well, and that's my question. Did Buddhism influence the fact that he wrote about this paradox, really, a paradox between a flame and then the rose, the terribleness of what was burning in London, and yet this rose, which represents, you know, the opposite, you might say, and this is true in Buddhism. And I wondered, was he thinking of Buddhism when he wrote that, or not? And then, how did he understand that in the Christian context? I mean, I'm aware of the Buddhist context, where all of suffering is identified with nirvana. But what does that mean to him, this flame and the rose, as a Christian?
Well, those are very complicated images. I mean, in a way, Eliot's entire oeuvre is wrapped in tongues of flame, because I don't know if you know the love song of J. Alfred Prufrock, but the epigraph to it is a voice out of hell speaking in tongues of flame, and then the tongues of flame end Little Gideon. But the fire and the rose, this is really a beautiful image of reconciliation and oneness and unity, but involving faith, because the flames become petals of a rose. Well, this is a beautiful image, but in the midst of war, in which you simply have to believe that all shall be well, and the fire and the rose are one, but of course, the rose is Dante's rose, the rose is the rose of Buddhism, the rose is Yeats' rose, the rose is feminine beauty, the rose is all of those things, tenderness, and the fire is suffering and the German bombers spitting tongues of flame. But it's an image of theodicy, I think. But it's an image that doesn't, I don't think it means that Eliot himself had totally reconciled the fire and the rose. But in presenting the image, he holds them together. And so you have beauty and suffering, you have tenderness and danger, you have all of this destruction and creation involved in this one image. It's a great image of reconciliation. And after the war, most of his work had to do with reconciliation. He had speeches in Germany and so forth and so on. But yes, it's a lovely image, and it definitely includes Buddhism. Dry Salvages has a lot of images from Buddhism, and the first part of Burnt Norton, the Lotus Rose. Yes, it's a complicated poem. I recommend that you read it. Yes. Other thoughts or questions?
Just one comment. It's not a question, but maybe
more.
Un commento, non è una domanda. Most of the audience, being non-American or Anglo-Saxon, probably are not aware that the Broadway play Cats is based on T.S. Eliot's poetry.
Yes, yes. And yes, Eliot wrote a book of, or a series of poems about cats. He loved cats for his godchildren, and was published as Old Possum's Book of Practical Cats. And after his death, it was made into a rock musical, and most of the words in Cats come from his poetry. Although the song Memory, which is the most famous poem there, the most famous song in Cats actually is obviously by someone who doesn't understand Elliot's poem, because she says, memory, I was beautiful then, let a new life begin, bring back the good memories, and so forth and so on. But with Elliot particularly, memory was not something that, not something to bring back. Memory was something that you needed to deal with in a different sort of way than this nostalgia and this longing that Gabriella, the glamour cat, has. Yes, that was by Elliot. And the Elliot's in the first half of the 20th century, Elliot was the most important figure in maybe in European literature and certainly in American and English literature. After his death, there was a re-evaluation, a reaction against him, a sort of neo-romanticism. That has now passed, and he is, and his work is all coming out. You know, most of Elliot's work was not published in his lifetime. He himself was a publisher, and he didn't want to publish things unless he thought they were worth publishing. Now we are bringing out everything because we think it's all worth publishing. So his wife, before she died, finally agreed that his work could all come out. Much of the negativity about Elliot has to do with the fact that he forbade a biography. He didn't want a biography to be written. He didn't want his letters to be published. He thought they were sort of beside the point. A number of biographers, his early biographers, thought this meant there were terrible skeletons in the audience and in the closet, and where they couldn't find them, they created them. And he is seen as an anti-Semite and as an elitist and all sorts of things by those critics. But now that has passed, and Elliot will certainly survive all that. I think he is the greatest poet of the century, certainly to write in English. Yeats, extremely great poet, but Yeats is an earlier figure, an earlier generation. Yeats died at the beginning of the Second World War. But I recommend four quartets to you, and I recommend the early Elliot too, you know. One of the tests, I think, of a great poet is how many lines of his can you remember? And, to read just one poem, The Love Song of J. Alfred Prufrock, never forget it. Yeah, it hangs in your mind, and you see the world through that. So he's a great poet. He's my favorite poet. Next to Dante and Milton.
Thank you so much. But before calling up again our musician to play a final song for us, just a few final words. Now, you indeed have whet our thirst for T.S. Eliot. And when I told Jewel after I had read her talk beforehand, I want to go back and read Eliot, four quartets again, she immediately pulled out a copy, her only copy with her, and gave it to me. So after I finish, you can come. Okay. So it's very, very hard to express what we have experienced in this hour with you, Jewel. You said at the beginning that you felt embraced by the love of everyone here. We feel that what you have given us is a gift of your love. You've given us T.S. Eliot and you've given us yourself. It has indeed been a moment of love, of mutual love. And to express that, you know, I didn't realize that I would be coming to this point, but I had noted down some words of Eliot, if you would permit me to quote. It's strange that words are so inadequate. Yet, like the asthmatic struggling for breath, so the lover must struggle for words. So that is what we are experiencing in this moment. Now we felt it's been a moment of sharing, deep, deep sharing. We would like to stay with you longer, but we must live in the present. And so we thank you again. And what we call the beginning is often the end. And to make an end is to make a beginning. That's Eliot again. No, the end is where we start from. So from the end of this moment here, we begin and go forward. So thank you so much. Now before Sandro, a moment before, I'd like to call up some representatives of Sophia students.